But kicking things off, I cannot think of a better, more appropriate way to begin this program than by talking with Mr. David Keene, the chairman of the American Conservative Union and the first vice president of the National Rifle Association. David, how are you, sir?
I'm great. It's a pleasure to be here.
It's great to have you. And once again, CPAC looks bigger and better than ever before.
It is going to be the biggest we've ever had. You know, back in 1973, we actually had 125 people. That was counting the speakers, one of whom was Ronald Reagan.
Wow.
So this year, on the 100th anniversary of his birth, we're going to have 11,000 people. And I think they're all imbued with his spirit. So that works out pretty well from our standpoint. I have to make one correction.
Yes, sir.
I am, as of yesterday, the former chairman of the American Conservative Union. I had a year more on my term, but I resigned because in April I... unless your listeners find out the truth about me, I expect to be elected president of the NRA. And it's been my feeling that you can't speak for two organizations, even though they have compatible and overlapping missions, but the missions are very different. So while I'll still be involved in CPAC, I will be spending most of my time and energy out promoting the Second Amendment.
Well, we're looking forward to that. And you know, you talk about the sort of convergence and the overlap. Obviously, not every gun owner in this country, not every NRA member is a conservative.
They're not even all Republicans.
That's true.
And that's fine. You know, until the late 1960s,
mm-hmm.
There was a consensus in this country, really a bipartisan consensus in favor of the Second Amendment. Hubert Humphrey was a life member of the National Rifle Association. It wasn't until you had sort of the urban radicals and the liberal movement take over the Democratic Party that mm-hmm. somehow this issue that everyone was on the same side of, except a few people, became an issue that was ideologically and partisanly divided. You know, in those days, prior to, say, 1965, the NRA was not seen primarily as an advocacy organization.
Right.
Because we didn't need to be
exactly.
seen that. We were a service organization. We provided competition. We did all the things that we still do. But because of what changed in the country, and because the Second Amendment became sort of a target for ideological reasons, the NRA had to essentially expand its mission so that today, most Americans, when you think of the NRA, really think of our advocacy role and our lobbying role on behalf of the Second Amendment issues. And that may well be, given the world we live in, the most important thing that we do. But it's not the only thing we do.
Absolutely. And, you know, you talk about how the issue started to change in the 1960s. I've been reading The Age of Reagan, Stephen Hayward's two-volume
right.
biography. And it was fascinating to me to read the Republican Party platform in 1972 and the draft in 1976. I got to tell you, David, you talk about the spirit of Ronald Reagan sort of imbuing CPAC. You look back in the 1970s and the shift had changed politically that rather than most Americans, regardless of party, supporting the idea of the Second Amendment, in the early 1970s, you had almost the opposite. You had the real drive to incorporate gun control platforms within the Republican Party.
That's right. There was a big effort on the part of gun controllers. They were more successful, obviously, in the Democratic Party. But there was a big effort back then, led by Kennedy and a lot of others, to try and get the country, with the support of a lot of the elites,
mm-hmm.
to accept gun control as something that was necessary and good. You had a couple of things going into that. First of all, you know, we don't talk about this so much when we're giving speeches in the South, but the NRA was formed after the Civil War by, among others, a group of Union officers, former Union officers, who realized that the problem that they had in the Civil War was that they're drawing their recruits from urban areas who didn't have familiarity with guns, even back in the 1860s. And that the Confederate Army was drawing their recruits from the more rural South, and they could outshoot them. So, and one of the reasons for the formation of the NRA was to broaden firearms experience and handling for civil defense purposes to the entire population. So the split, even then, mm-hmm. was urban-rural, because a lot of the heritage of the beginning of the country was beginning to be lost by people who'd never been outside the cities, by new people that came in from Europe who had no experience with guns. By the late 1960s, You had this wave of crime that was sweeping the country, as you'll remember. And in the cities, you know, the only thing that you could, when you thought of a gun, you thought of the guy that robbed the local 7-Eleven. In the countryside, the very different view. And so you had urban politicians saying, well, we know how to solve this problem. We'll take guns away from everybody. And that actually had traction at that time. And that's when the NRA really said, that's it. You know, we're going to have to, Camp Perry's fine. You know, and all these things are important. And we all want to go out and hunt deer and waterfowl and the rest. But we have got to protect the Second Amendment. If we don't, none of this other stuff is going to exist. So we went to work. The NRA transformed itself. The budget changed. The approach changed. And as a result of all that, we stopped them dead in their tracks. We stopped them certainly from getting what they wanted in one party, and they were, because of the base of the other party, we weren't successful. And in that party, there was a fight going on between the more moderate Democrats, who tended to be what? Rural Democrats, and the urban Democrats. So again, the urban guys saw, even within their own party, the question of guns as a dividing issue. And so it became the mantra of liberal urban Democrats that you had to be against guns. And that you had to be against the Second Amendment. And they came to dominate one of our major parties. And that created a danger that we still live with today.
Absolutely. You know, now we have the Heller decision. We have the McDonald decision. But you still have cities, including Washington, D.C., that are putting up these hurdles and these roadblocks for, you know, every law-abiding resident to be able to exercise that constitutional right. At some point, do you think that we will finally see the urban areas, I think it may be too much to ask that they embrace the Second Amendment, but they at least recognize that the Second Amendment exists?
Well, they now, in a legal sense, they recognize that it exists. They just say that reasonable regulation is reasonable even when it denies any practical, you know, application
right.
of the Second Amendment to real life. That's going to take a number of lawsuits. It's going to take some political uprisings in some of these areas, and it's going to get ironed out, but it's going to take a long time. It's going to cost a lot of money, and then they'll find some other way to go out about it. As you know, when you look at the anti-gun forces, you know, they started by trying to get legislation, which they couldn't get, and eventually after the 2000 election, they decided they better take guns off the table or they'd lose national elections. So they went to the cities and the states. And they had some success in little areas, but not very much. We beat them in most places. Then they went to the courts. They thought that would work. And now they've been struck down not just by the courts, but by the Supreme Court twice. And so what they're doing now is they're looking internationally. They're looking at the United Nations. They're looking at trying to circumvent the Second Amendment by treaty or by international covenant or whatever. I was asked to go to the last small arms conference at the UN by the Bush administration as the public delegate. And it became clear to me that even though at that time a lot of our members didn't recognize the primary threat, because maybe it wasn't the primary threat to their Second Amendment rights being at the UN,
right.
and because we had John Bolton there to draw the line and a president that would back him up, they thought we don't have to worry about that. But what's going on now, as another small arms conference is coming up, is that these folks who have failed democratically in this country, who failed in the courts, are now saying, how do we, they don't give up their goal.
Yeah.
They're saying, how can we accomplish that goal? And the way to do that is either directly with the complicity of the United States, which would be in the Small Arms Conference, or, and I saw this when I was there and there's more of it now, a treaty that doesn't involve us, which they're thinking about. If it dealt with the sale and export of sporting arms, which is what they're talking about, and they got that treaty signed by the European community, by Turkey, by Japan, and a couple of other countries, that would be 90% of the guns imported into this country for sporting purposes. There'd be no more of this. And we wouldn't have to sign that treaty. It could be signed by those other countries.
And around the United States.
And most of those countries are anti-gun,
yeah.
for the same reason that politicians here can be, because the firearms industry in any of these countries, the sporting arms industry, is so small that while it's important to gun owners, it's not important enough to really drive the politics of the country. Mm-hmm. The only people in America who think that Remington and Winchester can control national policy are editorial writers for the Washington Post.
Well, you know, when you talk about what's going on internationally, this weekend, actually, Switzerland is going to have a referendum mm-hmm. on whether or not to ban the military-issue firearms that have been in Swiss homes for hundreds of years.
That's right.
And to strictly regulate the private ownership of firearms. And this is opposed by the Swiss government. This is opposed by every political party in Switzerland. And yet, the people pushing this are the doctors groups, the guns as public health crowd, and a couple of other fringe groups that are really making this full court press. You know, if Switzerland turns its back on their on again a right that has existed for hundreds of years, I'm reminded of Ronald Reagan saying that we're the last best hope on earth. Right.
Oh, absolutely. And you know, the culture, the background, the legal guarantees, and the traditions of most of these European countries is very, very different than the traditions and the laws and things here. And they have no understanding. When I was at the Small Arms Conference, this idea came to me, which we're going to implement this year. But they think, everybody thinks that everybody's like them. So if you're a Frenchman, mm-hmm. You think that the NRA is maybe analogous to a gun group in France or whatever. And you don't realize that in the United States, the Second Amendment is championed by millions upon millions of people who own guns, use guns, collect guns, do all of the things that, and is also supported by non-gun owners who believe the Second Amendment is important. So they keep trying to get the U.S. to go along with this because this is reasonable, that's reasonable. They have no understanding of where we are. During that conference, Wayne decided to direct NRA members to, I don't know if you remember this, to send mail to the U.N.
Oh, I do remember this very well.
And almost closed down the damn building.
Hundreds of thousands of postcards.
They couldn't understand
in.
It because that wouldn't happen in any of those countries. And so that had a salutary effect in getting their attention. And some of them thought, you know, maybe this isn't as easy as we thought. Well, this year what we're going to do is we've invited ambassadors from all these countries to come to Pittsburgh. I think it is would be a good educational experience for the ambassador from France to see 70,000 gun owners and supporters of the Second Amendment gathered together in one place and to maybe go through that exhibit hall, because he has to send back to his government that, you know, this is serious stuff.
Yeah.
So,
absolutely.
But we're going to have a continuing battle because we're the only country that has these traditions.
Well, I hope that a couple of those ambassadors can stop by the set of NRANews.com.
They'd be interesting interviews.
I would love
they?
To interview these folks. Yeah. I really would, because it is such a, no pun intended, a foreign concept to me to think that that you know, citizens of a nation, individual human beings, don't have a right to defend themselves. That idea is just, I can't get my head around.
Well, remember, first of all, go to the history. Despotic governments don't want an armed population. Mm-hmm. That's the beginning. In aristocratic and authoritarian governments in Europe, game was owned by the king. So you didn't want people out shooting. That was oftentimes a capital crime
to kill
to shoot
king's
a pheasant
deer.
Or to kill his deer. So you didn't want him to have arms for that. You know, and so ultimately, you're not going to, if they aren't going to have arms, they aren't going to be able to protect themselves. So that's not one of the things. Eventually, the whole rationale for owning a firearm is gone. Not necessarily in the hearts. You know, the failure of gun control, in my view, the inability to keep people from having firearms is illustrated by the Soviet Union. Now, if there was ever a totalitarian state, it was the old Soviet Union. But there was an old Russian tradition that a warrior was buried with his arms. And so even into both world wars, before they couldn't do it anymore, if you were killed in battle, they buried your rifle with you. And there was a burgeoning underground business in the Soviet Union where they were digging up graves and selling people guns so they could go hunting or protect themselves. Now, if the Soviet Union couldn't keep its citizens from buying a firearm, legally or illegally,
yeah,
how are they going to do that anywhere else?
It's a wonderful point. David, again, I can't thank you enough for kicking off our coverage today. I want you to know, I don't know if you saw him yet, but Richard Dreyfuss is actually here at CPAC. Did you ever think you'd see a day where guys like Richard Dreyfuss are wanting to come here?
We wanted to make room for him on the stage.
Yeah.
The schedule, there's just, you know, everybody in Washington's running for president. So unless he declares, he doesn't get up. But the fact is that Richard Dreyfuss deserves some credit. He's much more liberal than you and I will ever be. And if I ever get that liberal, my wife will strangle me in my bed, so it won't be a problem. But the fact is that he's recognized one thing, and that is that kids aren't being taught anything about the Constitution and the civic responsibilities of citizens,
mm-hmm.
and he's doing God's work on that. And so he gets a lot of credit from me and from anybody else for doing it.
Well, good for him. Hey, David, thank you again, sir. I appreciate your time today.
My pleasure.
Look forward to talking to you again very
yep.
soon. David Keene, NRA First Vice President and outgoing Chairman of the American Conservative Union.